great to be in Dexter, Georgia. I'll be honest with you, I've been a lot of places, never been in Dexter. And it's great to be here, it really is. And, you know, this is my 51st year coaching college baseball. And it's great being anywhere at my age. In fact, we had professional baseball scout day. I coach now at the University of Alabama in Birmingham, helping out one of my former coaches. Then I coach on the Cape Cod League in the summer. That's where all the best college players play. I coach with the Hyannis Ball Club. But we have Pro Scout Day every year at UAB. And this really old scout, a good friend of mine, I went up to him and said, "Bill, it's great to see you." And he said, "Ron, it's great to be seen and not viewed." And for you older people back there, you understand what I'm talking about. But I'm going to get back to Jody in a little bit, but I really appreciate that, Jody. And Coach Brown asked me quite a while ago to speak at this event. And when he did, he knew I have a pretty busy schedule, but he said, "Coach, now, I hope you believe in the Constitution. I heard you did." And I said, "Yes." He said, "Now, I hope you believe in the Bill of Rights." I said, "Yeah, sure." "And how about free speech?" I said, "Yeah." He said, "Great, you're giving a free speech in Dexter, Georgia on this particular night." But anyway, there's no place I'd rather be than with these boys, good-looking young men, and the coaches, family members, people care about these youngsters. And go Raiders, right? Huh? Congratulations on winning the region championship last year. And what are you going to do for an encore? There's a state title possible, right? Let's see if we can get that wrapped up this spring. But when I came in, I was greeted warmly. I don't know too many people here. I'm going to introduce a couple of people that are real close to me also in a minute. But I heard two adult men talking. And I heard one say, "Who's speaking tonight?" And the other one said, "Oh, some old college baseball coach." So I leaned a little close, and the other one said, "You know, most of these old college baseball coaches are idiots." I went up to him and said, "Hey, I'm an old college baseball coach." He said, "Really? And I'm not an idiot, okay? So I just want to let you know I'm here to speak to the boys." And he said, "No, I just thought maybe you were an old college baseball coach." "I am. And I'm glad to be here. I really am. And I am old. But at the same time, I'm still young, still work with kids all year round, still do a lot of things. But I'm your after-dinner speaker, and you're stuck with me for a while. This TV station stuck with me from Dublin for a while. And I know the boys are saying, how long is this going to last? You imagine how many banquets I've been at that I had to listen to someone who bored me to death? I'm not going to bore you. I hope I can give you something that you can take back with me tomorrow as you start school, start your season. Won't be long before you key up there. But I can assure you, in regard to length, I follow the premise of what Henry VIII said to his ninth wife: I will not be keeping you long, okay? Plus, I got a 4-hour-and-a-half drive back to Birmingham, Alabama. But I'm used to it, so don't worry about me. I'll be okay, as long as I have my cigars and roll the window down and play the old radio station. But most of the places where I go, I get treated pretty well. The only place I'm always leery of speaking, see, I was at Mississippi State for 31 years, and Ole Miss is our big rival. I'm sure you guys follow Alabama and Auburn, as I do, but Ole Miss and Mississippi State, we don't like each other. We like the schools, but, you know, it's just a friendly rivalry. Well, Oxford, Mississippi is the home of the Rebels. And actually, they're the Black Bears now, okay? And so when I have to speak in Oxford, Mississippi, I'm not sure how I'm going to be received. I remember one of the first times I had to go up there, I was speaking at a father-son banquet at the First Baptist Church in downtown Oxford, Mississippi, home of Ole Miss. And I wasn't sure how I was going to be received, and I really got concerned, because the Baptists in Mississippi have those large marquees. I mean, Baptists are noted for those large marquees in front of the church, all lit up, talking about the sermon for the day. Well, that thing that day said, the sermon for today is, "Do you know what hell is?" And right below it said, "Come and hear Ron Polk speak tonight." And so that's my experience in Oxford, Mississippi for one of my speaking engagements. But Guys, can you imagine 51 years of coaching, 7 tours with the national team all over the world, in-house visits, recruiting, watching games, how many planes I've been on, how many hotels I've lived in, I mean, how much travel a guy has to do. And I'm not a very good traveler anymore. Some of you think, well, it must be great going to airports and flying on the planes. No, I mean, it gets old after a while. But basically, I'm not a happy camper sometimes, especially with airports and security and everything like that. But I always wonder why they're always late. You ever wonder why anybody work for Delta here? I have to fly Delta almost all the time. It's great airlines, it's always late. I went up to the counter one time, late again. I said, how does your plane travel 600 miles an hour and it's always late? I just don't understand that. You know, you think it could be on time at least once. But 2 weeks ago, I was in the Birmingham airport, had to speak in Charlotte, North Carolina, a big high school conglomerate banquet, a big one. And I had an early morning flight, 6 o'clock flight, Birmingham and Atlanta, Atlanta to Charlotte. I had to make a connection. Get to the airport around 4:45, wake up call like 3:30. I'm tired. I have to speak in Charlotte, and after that, I got to come back and go someplace else. So I get to the airport and look at the monitor. Plane's late. I got a connection in Atlanta, tight connection. I'm going to miss the connection. I'm going to have to get a rental car and drive to Charlotte. So I'm kind of upset to begin with. So I had nothing to do, so I went to the Hudson News, and you guys who travel, you know, they had Hudson News in every airport and got myself a USA Today. I'm a big reader of papers. And I was in a bad mood, and I gave her the money, and she gave me my change back. And I said to her, thank you, ma'am. And she didn't say a word to me, not one word. So I said to her, I said, ma'am, I just thanked you for this newspaper, and I just paid you. Are you not going to thank me back? And she said, sir, I gave you your receipt. Look on the bottom of your receipt. It said, thank you. I said, oh, I am sorry. I apologize. I didn't realize you have it on the bottom of the receipt. So that didn't get the day off very well. So now I go to the gate, and there was other planes late, not a seat to be had. I mean, we're talking about wall-to-wall people, lots standing. And I eyeballed a seat in the back, and I started walking fast. And a lady to my right was walking in the same direction. Now, I'm not going to say she's big, but she looked like a linebacker for the New England Patriots. She was a massive lady. And she sees me, and she starts walking quickly. I sped up. I mean, I'm getting old, and I don't care. You know, I'm going to get that seat. I beat her. She stood right in front of me. I sat down and looked up to her. She took up the whole space. And I said to her, I beat you. And she said, yes, you did. I said, moo, are you one of those women liber types? She said, yes, I am. I said, isn't that the organization that tells women to stand on their own 2 feet? She said, yes, it is. I said, well, you're standing on your own 2 feet. I'm sitting in this chair. That got off to a bad start. So I get on the plane, sound asleep, always get an aisle seat, sound asleep. Guy comes down the aisle. I don't know if you boys ever have asked this question before. Bangs me on the shoulder, wakes me up, and I look up and he said to me, sir, are you reading that newspaper that you're sitting on? I said, yes, I am. Then I did something really stupid. I stood up and turned a page and sat back down. I don't know if any of you boys fly at all, but you know, generally the first flight is always tough, you know, a little nervous. But so I sit down. After this guy woke me up, and this guy to my right on the window seat was shaking like a leaf. And I said, you okay? He said, yeah, I hate to fly. I'm so nervous. I said, calm down, calm down. It's not going to crash. And I said to him, I said, sir, do you realize there's more train crashes in this country each year than plane crashes? And he said, really? I said, yeah, there's more train crashes than plane crashes every year. And he said, well, that's good news. And I said, didn't you read the paper a couple of weeks ago? A train crashed in San Diego, California. He said, no, I didn't read that. And he said to me, well, how'd the train crash? Well, I had to tell him, well, a plane landed on top of it. So those are the type of stories you get sometimes as you travel.
For your tax return this year, call the reliable tax professionals at C&L Tax and Accounting Service.
Hi, I'm Brenda Chang. Come see us this year at C&L Tax and Accounting, where you can get your maximum refund.
Brenda Chang and her staff are trusted income tax preparers who take the time to give you good quality tax advice.
Come see us this year where we are offering the $750 cash advance loan.
C&L Tax and Accounting Service is located on Madison Street in Dublin.
White's Well Services is owned and operated by Herman White, who has over 50 years dedicated experience in hard-to-find water. White's Well Services. We take pride in our family-run business. We are honest, our crews are hardworking, and we have strong family values. We drill residential and commercial wells, and we offer full well and pump service within a 100-mile radius. 24-hour emergency services available. We offer free, no-obligation quotes and give our senior citizens a discount. Our policy, no water, no pay. Contact White's Well Services.
Recruiting, guys, I probably never see one of your boys again, but maybe one of these days that might happen. But like in Ronnie Morris, who I'll introduce in a second, I'm in people's home all the time, recruiting to come to wherever I coach. Coach at Georgia Southern, Statesboro, Georgia, 72-75, head coach. And went to Mississippi State, University of Georgia. So anytime you're recruiting, you're trying to sell yourself in the university. Never forget, I'm Tampa, Florida, many years ago. And this boy was in heavy traffic. For you boys, you have to understand, in the SEC, which I'm a product of, everybody wants the same kids. LSU, Florida, South Carolina, Arkansas. Well, I'm in heavy traffic. This is a good player. A shortstop, Tampa, Florida, in-home visit. Mom's here, dad's here, boy's here, grandma. She had to be about 95 years of age, is to my right. And I'm talking about Mississippi State and my coaching staff and the beautiful campus we have. And they're asking good questions, and I love peanuts, and there's a bowl of peanuts there, and I'm eating peanuts as I'm talking, and all of a sudden, the peanuts are gone. I love peanuts. And the grandma hadn't said a word all night, and I looked at my right, and I could see she was a little disturbed. I said, ma'am, I'm sorry, were these your peanuts? She said, she called me son. She said, oh yeah, son, those are my peanuts. But don't worry, all I've been able to do is, since I lost my teeth, I've been able to suck the chocolate out of the peanuts and put them in that bowl. I got a lot of stories on recruiting, as you can imagine. But you know, Jody mentioned a few things in regard to wins. You know, I'm going to tell you, I got more wins than any other coach in any sport, man or woman. One reason is we play a lot of baseball games. Nick Saban at Alabama, very successful coach until last week against Clemson. He'll never touch me. Plays 12 games a year. Someone in our office figured up he'd have to win 12 games a year for the next 244 years to catch me. All right, I don't think he's going to do that. But normally when I'm introduced, it's, you know, most wins. What they forget to say, I have more losses than any other coach in the history of sports. Why? Because we play 56 games plus tournaments. Baseball is a game you play almost every day. And I mention that because wins and losses are going to happen. It's a long longevity record. But one record I'm not so proud of, and this is, and everybody knows this, I led the SEC every year in getting thrown out of games. Never cussed an umpire. Don't believe in it. Never bumped an umpire. I just always said the wrong thing. And what happens, Mississippi State, we had 6,500 season ticket holders and 24 stations in the radio network and TV, many of our games, SEC TV network. And every time I get thrown out after the game, I do a press conference. The question is, first, what'd you say? What happened? The players ask me, what happened? Coaches say, what took place? And you people watching the game say, what did he say? I mean, what did he say to get thrown out of the ball game? Well, let me just give you just a few examples of how you get thrown out of a game by just what comes out of your mouth. Anybody here ever been to Fayetteville, Arkansas, University of Arkansas? Bomb Stadium, probably the nicest baseball stadium in the southeast of the country. We got some great stadium. Kentucky's building a $50 million stadium right now, and Alabama's new stadium is gorgeous. And it'll be facility wars, no question about it, but Bomb's the best. And several years ago, we were going to Fayetteville playing Friday, Saturday, Sunday. Normally it's cold in Fayetteville. It's up in the mountains. And the reason they're so rich in Fayetteville is Benton, Arkansas is right next door. That's the home of Walmart, all right, and Tyson Food. And so there's a lot of rich people in Fayetteville, Arkansas. So they built this monster of a stadium. So we come in on a Thursday practice. Friday, Saturday, Sunday, we're playing the Razorbacks. And we were ranked at that time number 3 in the country. And they were number 8 in the country. Beautiful night, which sometimes doesn't happen in Fayetteville, Arkansas. This place, let me tell you, batting practice sold out. I mean, standing room only, not a seat to be had in the entire facility. And I mean, you can't even believe how many people were there to watch the Bulldogs of Mississippi State play their Razorbacks. Well, anyway, about the 5th or 6th inning in that game, the plate umpire, I thought, may have graduated from the University of Arkansas. I mean, they were talking about you guys who pitch and hit, you like a consistent strike zone, you know, and just want some consistent. No. This guy was all over the place. No concept of what the strike zone, he was hurting my guys. So I went out, yeah, I got thrown out. And he gives me the big heave-ho, and all the Pig Suey fans are waving their keys at me, you know, and all that. So, you know, I took it, but I said to him when he threw me out, hey, where do you want me to go? Ump, you just threw me out. Look at this place. Not a seat to be had. Wall to wall. Where do you want me to go? He looked at me and said, Coach Polk, I don't care where you go, but just go someplace where I cannot see you. So I walked over and stood right on top of home plate. I said, you haven't seen a thing here all night. Oh, any Tennessee Vol fans here? Tennessee Vol fans? Been to Tennessee up in Knoxville? Well, what happens, you know, sometimes you get thrown out, and I always know when I'm leaving the game because I hand my lineup card to one of the assistant coaches, and they always say to me, see you after the game, coach. I knew I wasn't coming back. We're having a problem with this plate umpire. And so I get thrown out, but I thought to myself, you know I'm going to get thrown out. I grabbed my cell phone, stuck it in my right pocket. He throws me out of the game in Knoxville, Tennessee, playing the Vols. And after he threw me out, I said, oh, Mutz, ump, we just found this cell phone outside the umpire's dressing room. Did you drop your cell phone? And he looked at it and said, what makes you think that's my cell phone? And I said, because it's got 8 missed calls on it. That's why. He didn't appreciate that at all. LSU, Alex Box Stadium, coached against Skip Bergman and Paul Maneri and all those. Great venue, great competitive games always, Mississippi State against LSU. But LSU fans are the most rabid, obnoxious, and rude fans in the world. And sometimes those people even bring their husbands with them. How many times coaches have you yelled out from the bench to the plate umpire, where was that pitch at? Where was that pitch at? Where was that pitch at? Well, this umpire, he must have got awful tired of it. Packed house. Comes over the dugout slowly, brings me to the top step and said, Coach Polk, listen, I don't want to hear one more time, where was that pitch at? And then he said to me, and don't you know you don't end a sentence with a preposition? Must have been an English major. So I said, all right, where was that last pitch at, knucklehead? So I got thrown out of that game awful quick.
It's tax time, America, and time to get all your credits with Tax Time America, serving our community for more than 15 years. Tax Time America always provides you with friendly, professional tax preparation, always up to date on IRS rules and regulations. Tax Time America, your authorized e-file provider, a registered tax preparer, and a member of the Associated Tax Professionals. Tax Time America brings experience and ethical practices with no out-of-pocket fees. Refund anticipation checks within 7 to 14 days. Tax Time America, off North Jefferson, next to Cricket Wireless. Phone 274-8181. Tax Time America, getting their customers all their credits. Also offering a $1,000 tax advance.
Hi, I'm Curtis Edwards. I'm a member of the Dublin City Council, owner of Curtis Edwards Insurance here in Dublin, and a licensed realtor of K. Grayson Company Real Estate here in Dublin, Georgia. I'm proud to be a part of the Dublin community. I'm proud to be a sponsor of the Black History Month events. Please come join us and to celebrate this great time in Dublin, Georgia. The City of Dublin is proud of their history for African Americans, including the Martin Luther King Memorial that we worked so hard on and Across the Creek Cemetery project we worked hard on. We'd like to reach out and thank all the volunteers and all the business communities with their donations. We're proud of these projects and we're looking forward to many years of green and growing together.
Got any Auburn War Eagles here, huh? Oh, well, you all Georgia Bulldogs, right? Well, good, that's what you should be. But anyway, Auburn, Alabama, never forget, we have great fans. One travels with us all the time. A lot of people travel with us. This lady loved our players. And she had those loud voice. And she was an older lady, but she loved our boys, always sat right behind our dugout, on the road, at home. And she's always on the plate umpire. And this is a trained SEC umpire, as always. And they're known not to acknowledge anything said from the stands, because they hear a lot. And she's saying, you know, you are stupid, quit blanking behind the plate. How did we get you for this game? And she's on this plate umpire all night. I'm coaching third base, and I can hear it. You know, it was a big crowd, but it was a quiet crowd. And so she's on them. And all of a sudden, about the fifth or sixth inning, I'm coaching third. And she stands up and cups her hand. Everybody in the ballpark heard her. She screamed at that plate umpire, "Ump, if you were my husband, I would poison your drink." Boy, that got him. He took that mask off, looked right at her and said, "Ma'am, if you were my wife, I'd drink it." Oh, a lot of stories. But I guess, I think it was in Alabama several years ago. I went up to the home plate umpire, and I shouldn't have said it. I said, "You know, you're having a bad night. Would you throw me out of this game right now if I called you a crook?" He said, "Oh, you call me a crook, you're gone." I said, "Well, listen, would you throw me out of this game if I just thought you were a crook?" He said, "No, I couldn't do that." And I said, "Well, I think you're a crook." So I got thrown out of that game. And that was the game I came back in the dugout, and they asked, "Well, what happened?" Well, I told them the story. Plus, I said, I think I also got thrown out because, I basically kicked dirt all over home plate. And they said, "Well, that's no reason to get thrown out of a game." I said, "Yeah, but the umpire was sweeping of the plate at the time." And so, you know, those little things probably shouldn't have happened, but it happened. But I don't allow our players, I don't know if Jody remembered, you're not allowed to talk to the umpires, ever. Have a signal, remember the cap and the mask, and so I'm the only guy that can talk to the umpires. So that's basically why I get thrown out so much. But you know, with Jody and Coach Brown and the people that care about you guys and the administrators here and the football coach, and I always want to be a football coach. Where's the football coach at? Is he still? I always want to be a football coach, I really did. But then I decided I want to work with athletes. Only kidding. I've said that in front of some SEC football coaches. They give me wow. But, you know, discipline, right? It's what it's all about. Discipline, structure, organization. We'll talk a little bit about that a little later. I'm a disciplined guy, right, Coach? Ron? Patty? Right? Discipline, structure. I learned it from my dad. I grew up in Phoenix, Arizona. My dad was a mail carrier. I don't know if any of you boys or people have been in Phoenix. It's hot, especially in the summertime. And we're talking about 112, 113 degrees, and they say no humidity. You're like, heck, makes no difference, 112, 113 degrees. This was the mid-50s, and he had to carry mail throughout the entire neighborhood. Now they got trucks, they got carts, they got bicycles. No, those days, the satchel, and carried it all day. And Mondays was magazine day. You know, that means that bag is heavy. And so every Monday morning, my dad got up on Monday morning to help us with breakfast, me and my brother Bob, who still lives out there. And he was always cranky. I can understand it. He's got to carry mail for 6 days, only day off Sunday. And this is magazine day. Monday morning, we made sure that we were very nice to Dad because, you know, Dad has got a long day ahead of him, a long week. My dad was tough. Now, I knew what corporal punishment was. You can't use it in the school. You can't hit a kid, but I got pelted. I mean, I got just whipped. And my brother Bob did, but he cared for us. He'd hit us and say, "I love you." I said, "Well, if you love me, you wouldn't have hit me so hard." But anyway, he was tough, but I loved him. So I can still remember the day I learned discipline. We're down for breakfast. Bob is 10. I'm 7 years old. Bob's in third grade. He didn't like school. Didn't like his third grade teacher. So Monday morning, Bob is miserable. So I got a brother, Bob, miserable. Dad is miserable. I'm 7 years old. And since Dad's miserable and Bob's miserable, I will probably be miserable also. And I'll never forget, my dad asked my brother, Bob, now 10 years old, Bob, what do you want for breakfast this morning? That's an easy question. Bob, what do you want for breakfast this morning? Bob must have been in a bad mood, 10 years old. He said to my dad, Dad, I'll have some of that damn cereal over there. I never saw my dad move as fast as he did. He threw that chair out, he ran around that table and just, hey, waylaid my brother Bob. Into the ground, he's crying, he's bawling, and I'm 7 years old and I'm shaking like a leaf. He finishes with him, slowly walks back and sits down and looks at me, his seven-year-old son, and asks me the same question. Now, Ron, what do you want for breakfast this morning? And the day I learned discipline, when I said to him, gee, Dad, I don't know, but I don't want that damn cereal, I'll tell you that. That was the day I probably decided to become a coach. But what I do every time I speak, I handwrite notes to our secretary there at UAB, and she types them up for me. And tonight, or this afternoon, before I left, I said, now go ahead and take these notes, you type fast, and as you see my handwritten notes, if you see anything that's not funny or boring, these kids would not like to hear, just don't type it up. So I'm going to handwrite my notes for tonight, and you type it up, and I'll bring it to West Lawrence High School, and that's what I'm going to do tonight. So she kind of typed up what I gave her. So here we go for tonight. So in conclusion, it's been great being here tonight. I think it's about time to go home. But hey, we got a young man here in this right in front of me who has an announcement to make. And he saw me when I came in, and he said, Coach, can you make an announcement for me tonight? I said, why don't you make it? He said, no, I don't like to speak in front of large crowds, and my teammates are here, and my parents are here, and I'll be nervous. And would you make the announcement? I said, sure. And he told me. And I said, oh, my gosh, that is fantastic. I'll be happy to make that. This is the greatest. I mean, I'm so happy for this kid. And wait till you guys hear what happened to him last night. I mean, and I'm going to make it for you. Zach Thomas, get up here. Come on, Zach, quick. How you doing, big guy?
Good.
Just stand right over here, Zach. I'll tell you what. I'm honored that you allowed me to do this, okay? I'm very happy for you. I'm proud of you. Your teammates are happy for you. They're going to be proud of you when they hear what happened to you last night. Are your parents here?
Yes, sir.
They're going to be proud of you also. Everybody is going to be proud. A once-in-a-lifetime experience, a young man happened to this boy last night. About 9:30, he tells me, this boy achieved puberty. Congratulations. Zach, I'm sorry. Zach, I apologize. We all know you haven't achieved puberty yet, so hang in there, okay? You know, oftentimes at these banquets with the boys, some of you guys I could have used that on too. Sometimes boys bring dates with them, a girlfriend. And I think that's great when a boy says, honey, listen, I've got a banquet preseason and I'm going to make money for our Raiders baseball program. I'd like for you to come and be a part of this. And so I think it's really nice when a boy does that, that brings a girlfriend. And we do have a young man who brought his girlfriend up here. Nolan Daniel, come up here, Nolan. Bring your girlfriend up here. Come on, where you at? Oh, here you are. Good. How you doing?
I'm good. How are you?
You stand next to me. You stand on the outside, right here. Just move. I'm gonna ask him. We all know you. You guys all know him. Everybody knows Nolan, right? But we don't know much about your girlfriend, so I'm going to just ask some questions and you just answer them, okay? What's her first and last name?
Zoe Heron.
Louder.
Zoe Heron.
And what year in school is she?
She's a senior.
And how long have you known her?
Since freshman year.
Okay, what year are you?
I'm a junior.
Junior, so it's been a pretty good long time. All right, does she have any brothers or sisters at the home? At her home?
Yes, sir. She does.
What are their names?
Zach and Gavin.
Does she have any pets, dogs, or cats?
Yes, sir.
What's their names?
There's a cat named Izzy, and there's a... she has like three dogs, no, four dogs.
I don't know the dog's names.
Guy knows the cat's name, but not the dog's name. All right, next question. Does she date other boys?
No, sir.
All right, I want you to hold her hand, look in her eyes. Both of you hold your hands together. Hold her hand. Look at her eyes. Other hand, too. All right, next question. Do you love this girl?
Yes, sir.
All right, get down on one knee. And hold her hand. And repeat after me. Will you help me get up?
Help me get up.
Okay, good. Take her back. Good. Thank you. Waco, Texas, several years ago, two junior kids did the same thing. And just when I said, Will, he yelled out, you marry me! And I said, get your butt off the ground. Mom and Dad wasn't happy at all, as you can imagine.
Welcome to Sears Hometown Store in Dublin. I'm Andrew Poole, and I want to invite you in today. Come see our great selection of bedding, where you will always get 50% off. And be sure to ask us about our no-credit lease. Sears Hometown Store. Brands, knowledge, service, price. Locally owned and operated. We're conveniently located at Hillcrest Parkway. Come see us or call us at 272-3600. Sears Hometown Store in Dublin is your local destination for home appliances. Come see us soon.
I enjoy making people laugh. It gets the kids' attention. Now I want you guys to do me a favor. I want you guys to do me a favor. Give me eye contact, because I'm here for you. You know, I may never see one of you guys again. Very possible. So before you leave here tonight, I hope that I make a difference in maybe possibly one or two, three or four guys' life. Because you're going to hear from an old coach who's been around kids. Now, I don't coach kids your age. My guys in USA and college, 18, 19, 20, 21, sometimes 22, but I've done clinics and camps with guys your age. So I know what's going on in your mind. I know what the problem that sometimes you have, especially in this day and age. And moms and dads out here, you gotta love them. I mean, good-looking boys, they're dressed nice, and they're here at the great school, and great coaches, and great administrators, and people who love them and care for them, but we don't wanna lose them. And we don't wanna lose these guys, and it's easy to lose kids nowadays with all the distractions they have. So discipline them, structure their lives, and help them out as best we can. And that's very important for me to pass on, because the distractions are immense. They're all over the place. When we went to school, we didn't have anything close to the distractions that these young men have. You all, who older people, understand what I'm talking about. There's no question in my mind that you got to be proud of them, and you got to raise them well, and love them, and nurture them, and guide them, and understand that the distractions are immense. I'm just going to give you a couple of distractions we need to deal with, okay? Outside this beautiful cafeteria at this beautiful school, there are a lot of kids, boys especially, who would like to be where you guys are. Healthy, come from good families, playing for a good coach, playing the national pastime on a team that had great success last year. They're envious of you. They'd like to be you. And some girls also say the same thing. They'd like to emulate the way you handle yourself, because you're athletes, you're somewhat role models. But also outside this school, I don't care if we're in Fort Lauderdale, Florida, or I coach up in Hyannis, Mass., a very liberal area, kids wandering around looking like dirt. I mean, just baggy pants and girls with spiked hair and guys with earrings and nose rings. And I just say to myself, I kind of feel sorry for those kids, but where's their direction? Where's their people that care about them enough to make sure they understand they got a life to lead, and they got to get rid of some of the stuff that causes people to be concerned? But What happens also in this school, and I don't know anything about this school other than knowing your coaches, it appears to be a very clean school, very nice school, but there's a lot of kids in this school who would like you to come with them. They're what you call the good timers. They're the people that say, hey, why are you going to school every day? Why are you studying? Why do you go to church each Sunday? Why don't you come with us? Why are you playing baseball? You know, why don't you come with us? We're having a ball. High school is supposed to be the best time of your life. Why are you doing that? It's got to be boring doing those things. We're having parties. We're having a blast. We got alcohol, and occasionally we have some drugs available. Come with us. We're the in crowd. We're the fun people. Be a part of the in crowd. And kids your age, unfortunately, all over the country fall for that, and they give up some of the most important things in their life. Because, guys, I can tell you, I think we got 13, 14, 15, 16, 17-year-olds. There's no question in my mind. Being around the block, being around kids all my life, the next 2, 3, or 4, or 5 years of your life, boys, will determine pretty much what you become the rest of your life. Your character, your morals, your ethics, your resume, your degree, a scholarship, what you do in these most formative years of your life will determine what you become the rest of your life. And if you go with those people and you be a part of the in crowd, you become one of those good timers, you get the reputation of a fun guy that likes to party, and you do that all the time, and it takes you away from your family, from your church, from the kids who care about you, your coaches, your teachers, people who really love you. You go that route. And then when you're 18 or 19, you look back and say, boy, I wish I could go back and start all over again as a freshman or sophomore in high school, because I don't have the credentials. I don't have the grades. I don't have the transcripts. I don't have the people writing me letters of recommendation. And then you're looking for those people when you leave West Lawrence High School. The good timers took you away from the most important years of your life, setting the groundwork with the rest of your life. You look for them. They either left Dublin or Dexter, or you don't have a phone number anymore for them. They're gone. They've left this area. And all of a sudden, what did they leave you? A life of misery, because now you've got a long, long way to go. Sometimes I see people hanging around. I ask them questions, and they all say to me the same thing. Boy, I wish I had to do it all over again. I can't do this, and I can't do that. I don't want to walk in, meet one of you guys in Atlanta or something. You say, I remember you talked to us. And I was hanging around with a bad crowd. They're not bad kids. They just don't have direction. And I went that way. I went with the parties, the drug scene, and I took away from my school, my religion, my family, my coaching, my coaches, and Coach, I wish I would have listened, because I now believe you that those 2, 3, or 4 years of my life were the most important years of my life. And I've seen some kids wander around because of the fact that they didn't have direction. So parents, I just challenge you. These distractions are immense. I go down to Dominican Republic every year, 9 tours now, doing clinics all over the island. Anybody been in Dominican Republic? You have? So you know how the poverty is down. Did you go down there with a baseball team? So you go with Score International or just vacation or what?
Mission trip.
Mission trip, good. A lot of mission trips down there. It's a third world country. But there's either rich or poor. Anyway, Dominican Republic shares an island with Haiti. And Haiti's been really dealt a bad blow the last several years with the earthquake, and they already were one of the more impoverished areas. I've coached in Cuba 3 times and Nicaragua. Nothing's like Haiti. Dominican's close. Those poor kids have nothing. Most of them. You can't believe the houses they live in. They wouldn't be called houses. Most of them don't have bathrooms. They share an outhouse with the community. Air conditioning is a luxury, and it's always hot down there. Don't see any satellite TV dishes on the roofs. They don't see any antennas. They have no cell phones. All the kids I work with, I don't care what age, never seen a cell phone. They don't have them. PlayStations, computers, forget it. They go to school 3 hours in the morning or 3 in the afternoon because there's no air conditioning in the schools there. That's all they can handle. But you know what? They're outside doing what? All day, playing baseball and practicing in the worst field conditions you can imagine. Burlap sacks for the bases, no mound, just a strip of paper, no backstop. You throw a pitch and it goes down the road. Outfield fences, nothing. Bullpens, forget it. Bathrooms are in the trees. I mean, the worst field conditions you can imagine. Goats cut their grass. They don't have lawnmowers in some of the sugarcane villages. I'm saying this because I'm telling you about distractions. Why are they now dominating the American National League, a country of 11 million people? 11 million people, over 85 now in the big leagues, over 300 in the minor leagues right now. They're predicting as more and more get developed, eventually the American National League All-Star Game will be Cubans, now that it's open, Venezuelans, Puerto Ricans, and Dominicans. For only one reason, nothing against you guys as athletes. They do what they want to do to get off the island, so they don't have to cut sugarcane for the rest of their life at $6 a day in the heat with machetes. Just think if you had no distractions. No distractions with the good timers. No distractions. Now, I understand what cell phones are all about. I call them dumbed-down phones. I tell our kids at UAB, put that dumbed-down phone away and talk to each other. Don't talk anymore. Up in the Cape, as soon as the game's over, first thing they do, go to the locker, get their phone out, check their messages. That's fine. But how's that going to help you? How's messages going to help you? How is PlayStations and playing games and texting and Instagram and all that? I know the names. I just don't do it. I don't do it. And the reason is, I don't want to be distracted. And I have some kids right now who are basically not throwing their cell phone away, but they're getting away from it because why? It's a distraction. They want to be a baseball player. They want to be a musician. They want to be a great student. They want to be a great brother, a great son. And anything that takes away from that is going to hurt them for the rest of their life. So I'm just asking you boys. I'm not telling you to throw it away. I'm just saying use it. But at the same time, understand it is a distraction. Those kids in Dominican don't have distractions. They're doing something that they want to do. And they're going to be the best of the best. So the good timers and the distractions of the social media are big factors. And I see a lot of you parents shaking your heads up and down. We all realize that.
Tax season is here, and Jackson's Income Tax Service is open and ready to serve you. We've started processing tax returns now, so don't delay. Come in today and get your taxes done and out of the way. Yes, you can come in with your last check stub for an estimate or get your return completely processed with your year-end W-2s and other tax documents. The season is here, and we look forward to doing business with you. We can be reached year-round at 610 North Church Street, right here in downtown Dublin. Open from 9 to 5, Monday through Friday. Call us at 272-8681. Jackson's Income Tax Service, established in 1987, providing quality customer service and maintaining an ethical and professional tax practice. Come to Jackson's Income Tax Service, where experience makes the difference.
Come to Jackson's Income Tax Service, where experience makes the difference.
Join Piggly Wiggly in the celebration of our 100th anniversary. And the celebration is spreading throughout our community with a renewed pride in our hometown grocer, Piggly Wiggly. 100 years of great product and great customer service. Piggly Wiggly is where you'll find everything from the freshest in produce to 100% certified Angus beef. The only certified Angus beef dealer in Lawrence County. Piggly Wiggly. Down home, down the street. Thanks for joining us in our 100th anniversary celebration.
Let me finish by three quick stories, boys. Now, here's my goal. I got a 4.5-hour drive from here back to Birmingham. We got practice tomorrow. Then I got another banquet, Spanish Fort, Alabama. Next day, another banquet, Gulf Shores, Alabama. Next banquet, Pontotoc, Mississippi. Next banquet, Florence, Alabama. Next banquet, Thorsby, Alabama. It just goes on and on. Do I enjoy it? Yes. Do I enjoy the travel? Absolutely not. Why am I here? I got a message for you, and I'm going to give it in four quick stories. Now, if you listen to it, now some of you guys say, well, I have to listen to these stories. You're going to say, what has he got to offer me? I don't know you guys. I don't know what kind of family background you have. I don't know how good a baseball player you are, but I know if you're a young man at this age that you have good days and bad days. There's no question about it in all aspects of your life. I'm going to give you four quick stories. If you're struggling right now with the good timers, people taking you away, not working hard at school, not going to church or praying to a higher being, not respecting your coaches or your teachers, if you're wandering around, you're going to be one of those guys, unfortunately, if you see me, say, boy, I wish I could go back and do it over again. I can't do this. I can't do that. I get tired of hearing that. Boy, I can't do this. I wish I could do it all over again. Make it happen now, because the next 2 or 3 or 4 years of your life, boys will make the decision what you become the rest of your life. Don't question it. Don't question it whatsoever. You heard this from your mom and dad and your principals and superintendents and your coaches and people who care about you. Understand how important these years are. Now, when I leave here, you're all going to shake my hand, whether you want to or not. You're not going out a side door. We have side doors here. We're going out that door, and I'm going to shake every one of your hand. And I'll tell you right at the end what I want you to do. Let me give you a few stories. If you listen to all four, if you're struggling right now in some aspect of your life, just listen to these four stories. I'm giving you the keys to success in high school. I'm giving you the keys to success at the next level of school. I'm giving you the keys to success from a coach. You wouldn't be interested in this banquet if I taught English, would you? Come to listen to English teacher talk? English teachers are great, but a coach has a little bit more because of the publicity you get. I'm telling you the truth. Believe me. First story. I do a lot of traveling. Columbus, Ohio has a baseball program that's the best in the state of Ohio. We hope as this program here becomes the best in the state of Georgia in your class. This is the best baseball program by far. Always successful. Always in the state title. They're good. And this one boy, Billy, is a senior on the team. And he was named captain of the team. Now, I've had captains. If you remember, Jody, players picked them. I think at Georgia Southern, I think I had captains. I'm not sure. But all the time in the SEC, the players picked them. You know, I know how I thought we're leaders, but let the players make the decision. Most of the time, it's seniors. Sometimes they'll pick a junior. Most of the time, it's the better players, the best hitter, the better pitcher. I don't care. Give me two. Two hitters, two pitchers, one on one. I don't care. Who's the guy who comes to home plate to exchange lineup cards? I was the only one in the history, I think, of college baseball, brought the captains up to home plate. I thought it was important for them to meet the umpires, meet the coach. Who's going to speak at the preseason press conference? If we have an award, something, or go to a dinner, who's going to stand up and thank the people for coming from the player's perspective? These are your cap. These are the guys you love. These are your leaders. Well, Billy was captain. So you said, well, Billy must have been really good. Well, he was a senior. This guy never started a game in 4 years. How's that happen? How do you become a captain if you never play in a game as a starter? He was there all the time. All the time. Early for games, early for practice. Yes, sir, no, sir. Always encouraging, patting the guys in the back, picking them up. Straight A student, just the nicest kid you ever want. So they honored him by naming him captain. What an honor. And all of a sudden, they're having a game on Friday, big rival, Columbus, Ohio. Tuesday, they're practicing. Wednesday, they're going to practice. Thursday, they didn't have any games other than this final game. Who's going to be a state title finalist? And all of a sudden, practice stopped on Tuesday because they looked up over the first base dugout and the administration building was on a hill. There was a dirt trail coming down. They saw the assistant principal in charge of discipline coming down the hill in high heels, and she was almost running. And that, they knew, hey, something happened. We got a problem. Practice stopped. They all went to the mound. The head coach quickly walked over to the dugout, and they saw their head coach put his head down. And all the kids started thinking, uh-oh. Something's happened to somebody on our team. Sure enough, the coach finished with the principal. She stayed in the dugout. He walked over to the team, pulled Billy out, their boy, their friend, their captain, put his arm around him, walked him to the dugout, and they saw their boy, their friend, walk up that hill with that lady. Coach came back, gathered them all around the mound, said, let's say a prayer. Billy's dad has just passed away. Now, as a college coach, I've had grandparents. Not too many parents because of the age, but it's tough for a high school boy to lose a dad. And so they said a prayer. Practice continued, but it didn't go well. Wednesday they practiced. Thursday is a funeral. The whole team was there, all the coaches, for Billy's dad's funeral. Friday's the game. Pre-game batting practice, you all do it. Infield, outfield, before everything started, Billy's back early, as always. And went to the head coach and just said, Coach, appreciate you bringing my teammates to the funeral. Really, my mom and our family appreciate it so much. And thank you for you coming and You know, I miss my dad already. In fact, I've read some awful, very awful. It's tragic. But at the same time, I'm here. And would you do me a favor, Coach? Can you play me today? Can you get me in the game? And if you can you start me? Well, the coach, you know, it was a big game. He really didn't want to do it, but said, Billy, I'm going to do it. I'm going to put you at third and take Tommy and put him in left and make the left fielder and make him a DH. We're going to start you. And we'll see how long we can, you know, you can play. And he did. He made two errors. He didn't get a hit, but they won the game. Played hard. Didn't happen. Not a good player. Game's over. Everybody's leaving. Billy stayed behind. Wanted to thank the coach. And he did. He thanked him for letting him play today. And the coach said, well, why was it so important? He said, Coach, you didn't know. I never told you or any of the coaches or my teammates, but my mom and dad never missed a home game. They knew I wasn't going to play, but they loved me. They never missed a home game. My mom had to help my dad out of the car, have a certain seat for him, because my dad's been a diabetic since I was born. He's been blind since I was born. And Coach, today was the first day my dad got a chance to see me play in a baseball game. Guys, tomorrow at school, if you have as much faith as Billy, isn't it going to be a better day? A little smile on your face. You're going to be kinder to a lot of people. I'm not here to preach. I'm just saying, if you don't have it, find it. You'll make high school a lot better. You'll make the next level of your life a lot better. And the next three stories go very quick. I know for a fact you guys have good days and bad days. You have good hair days or bad hair days. Mostly bad. Good girlfriend day, bad girlfriend day. Good mom day, bad mom day. Good coach day, bad coach day. Grumpy. Hey, teenage years, right? You're all the same way. I'm grumpy at times too. I try not to be. They have good days and bad days, but sometimes they're not mature enough to handle the bad days. Let's help them out as family, as coaches, as teachers. You can't all be all good. Quick story, this Russian came over when Moscow was even more of a dictatorship now. He was an auto dealer. And they're in this Midwest auto factory. And over the factory was a big balcony. And they're standing there, the host American, the Russian in broken English and broken Russian with a translator. They're working on a deal. And all of a sudden, the lunch whistle goes off at noontime. And it's shrilled through the factory. And all the 500 or so workers got up and walked out. And the Russian said to his host, the American, stop your workers, close the doors. Your workers are escaping. And the host said, no, they'll be back. And in 45 minutes, that same whistle blew. And they all came back and started sitting down and started to work. The Russian was amazed. He said, hey, I'm going to buy a lot of your auto parts, but I want to buy as many of those whistles as I can and take them back to Russia. Wouldn't it be nice if each one of you guys, if you're in a slump, can't throw a strike, not doing good in school, but you know, just blew a whistle? You got to get back on track again. How important the next two or three or four years of your life. You can't let it get you down. You're mad at your coach, get over it. Go into the coach's office one day and say to the coach, Coach Brown or Coach Pollock or any other coach, Coach, how's your day going today? Has any kid ever walked in? No, he said, Coach, I got a problem, right? Coach Pollock, how's your day going? How's your wife doing? How's your two kids doing? No, why don't you do that? Oh, I can't do that, especially if someone's watching. Why not? Mom, I love you. Dad, I love you. Hey, have a whistle, because you're going to have bad days. Wouldn't it be nice if all these kids had that whistle and never had a bad day? You're saying, yeah, for sure. No question about it. So I've given you faith. If you do that, tomorrow's a better day. Tomorrow's a great day if you don't have a bad day ever. And if you start having a bad day, you blow a whistle. Third thing is, little boy in downtown Manhattan. Skyscrapers. There's no skyscrapers in Dexter. I haven't seen them. Might not be any elevators in Dexter. I don't know. I love a small town. I coached in Statesboro and Starkville and Athens, and I think it's great. Some of you say, I wish I had lived in a big town. No, you don't. I've been to Chicago, New York, and San Francisco. You get a lot of recognition if you do something academically, athletically, or socially, and everybody knows you're the special person. You're not going to make the paper in the New York Times. I don't care how many home runs you hit that day. It's nice being in a small town with people who care about you. All right, this boy's in downtown Manhattan on vacation, mom and dad. He cannot see the top of the skyscrapers. Trump Tower, I'm sure, is there. The Empire State Building. And he says to mom and dad, I don't believe. The guy or the girl, they, billionaires, how can you build these buildings? And there was a construction site. There was a couple of buildings going on. And there was a trailer. And the little boy said to mom and dad, maybe the person who builds these is in the trailer. And they said, no, he wouldn't be in the trailer. But we'll go ahead and knock and ask. And he was there. And he came out, and he was so nice. And this seven-year-old boy patted him on the head and said, nice to have you in New York. And what do you have any questions for me? I'm the builder. I'm the developer. And I got two more going up. And this building here and that one there is mine. And the boy asked him typical seven-year-old questions. One is, how rich are you? How rich are you? Man said, well, you know, I've done pretty well. You know, these are my buildings. And he said then, the little boy, have you always been rich? And he said, no, I was a worker. I love my workers, my construction guys. I was a construction guy. I mean, that's all I did. I was just a regular old construction guy on one of the projects. But I made a decision. I was not going to be just a construction worker. I'm going to be something successful. You know what I did, big guy? I came to work early. I stayed late. I didn't take a big, long lunch hour like everybody else. I outworked everybody else because I wanted to be successful. But I knew I had to be noticed. So see my guys now, white shirts and blue and gray? I wore the brightest red shirt every day. Every day. And the reason is, I was going to outwork everybody. I wanted to be noticed by people who had decisions to make. I became a foreman, a superintendent. And I got with some people. We started shopping centers. And all of a sudden, just because that day, I decided I'm going to be something special and bought a red shirt so I can be noticed. Wouldn't it be nice if each player here, Coach Brown and Coach Pollock, wanted to be the player in the state of Georgia rather than a player? Who wants to be a first baseman? You want to be the first baseman. The student in English class, not a student. If you're going to have a heart transplant, you older people, you're going to ask for who's the heart doctor in Dexter or Dublin. You want to say, who's the heart doctor, right? Why don't you want to be the player, the student? Separate yourself from others. Buy a red shirt. Work hard at everything you do. So one story is the faith. Two, never have a bad day. If you do, blow a whistle. Three, start tomorrow in school, in what you do. You're going to be something successful. God does not mind you being successful as long as you do it, playing by the rules. And the last thing I'm going to tell you, if you have faith, you have that whistle, the red shirt, why don't you all want to make a difference in other people's lives every day?
Dublin Chrysler would like to welcome Graham Slater to the family.
Welcome to the family.
Dublin Chrysler Dodge Jeep Ram has a long tradition of service after the sale. And now with Graham Slater heading up our sales team, you'll be treated better than ever.
I'm Graham Slater, and I'm proud to bring 40 years of experience at Dublin Chrysler. I'd like to invite all my past customers to come see me for a fantastic deal on your next automobile. Don't get taken for a ride, Middle Georgia. Come see me at Dublin Chrysler, across the street from John Deere on 441 South, or call me at 272-3500.
Hello, ladies and gentlemen. We've got two amazing people with us here today. A part of, they've been coached, of course, by Mr. Ron Polk, and we've got his beautiful wife with us. Why don't you two introduce yourself to us a little bit and tell us all about you?
Well, I'm Patty. I'm a retired teacher. We have two children, three grandchildren, all boys. And my son and his wife are both educators. My daughter is in the retail business.
That's very good, very good. Sir, how about you?
Name is Ron Morris, and I'm from Douglas, Georgia, and I'm a New York Life insurance agent. 32 years.
Yeah. Wonderful. Well, listen, we're so glad to have you down here on the campus of the West Lawrence Raiders, and we want to talk about what your affiliation is with Coach Ron Polk.
I played for Coach Polk in 1974 and 1975 at Georgia Southern College, which is now Georgia Southern University.
Right. And so when you hear him speak, what kind of thoughts go into your mind as far as how he was as a coach, and now when you see him mentor so many young men?
Just knowing that these kids are hearing, you know, firsthand of what it takes to be successful.
Mm-hmm.
And, you know, it's not all about winning.
Right.
You know, there's a lot of different attributes that you have to be successful. And he names them all.
Mm-hmm. I mean, did he instill a lot of things within you during those years?
He did.
Yeah.
He, commitment.
Mm-hmm.
Organization, preparation.
Yeah, the value of other teammates.
Right. And Patty, let's ask you this question. Okay. With you being an educator, have been an educator for many years, when you see student athletes and when you know what it takes for them in the classroom as well to excel on the courts and on the fields, what are your thoughts about that?
Well, I just wish that all of them could hear what he said tonight. He is really an inspiration, and he makes it just so real. He makes it so real.
He's hilarious.
He is funny. And he has always been funny. He's a jewel. He really is.
And, you know, just listening to him, he just seems so genuine. And, you know, there's a lot of, when you get a little older, you do become a storyteller, so to say. And, of course, and in those stories that are being told, there's so many life lessons.
Yeah, Coach Polk, though, you're talking about being funny. A lot of times he wasn't funny in the dugout. Now.
Well, we can tell that from the, it's not funny until after the fact.
Yeah, right. It's funny when it's all
exactly.
Over.
Yeah. And, you know, and it does require a certain amount of discipline to be student athletes and to be able to excel in such a way, because it's more to it than just being talented.
Oh, absolutely. These kids have to, like he said, they have to block out so many distractions.
Mm-hmm.
There's so much out there trying to tear them down.
Mm-hmm.
And, you know, they don't have a clue what they want. They really don't know.
Right.
They just need to do everything that they do well and then see what happens, see where they end up.
You're exactly right. And, sir, if you could give a word to the students out there, to the young men, to the young women who are athletes, what message would you like to give them in a way of staying focused and committed?
Yeah, just get up every day with the commitment of doing your very best. And again, it's not about winning, you know, who wins on the scoreboard.
Yeah.
It's about going through the day winning many, many times.
Absolutely. Winning in life.
Yeah.
Winning in life.
Well, it's so good to meet both of you. Thank you so much for coming out here, of course, in support of Ron Polk. And thank you for encouraging the kids.
Well, thank you, Pat. Right.
Thank you.
Thank you both.
Bye-bye.
All right, ladies and gentlemen, hello. We are here at the campus of the West Lawrence Raiders here for their baseball team's fundraiser. And, of course, we've got assistant coach Pollock with us today. How are you, Coach?
I'm good. How are you?
Doing very well. Coach, here it is. This is your first fundraiser for the baseball team, correct?
Yes, ma'am. It was.
All right. Talk to us about everything.
We had a fundraiser. We had was fortunate enough to have Coach Polk come speak to us and didn't charge us anything.
Wow.
It was pretty much where a way for our players to offset the cost of the year this year. So they've got so much that they're responsible for. So every ticket they sold went toward paying that off. So
that's
it was
wonderful.
You know, a really good night with a really great message.
And you had a crowd tonight.
We did have a crowd. I think we sold right around 201 tickets. So we were very pleased. Our guys did a really good job. And, you know, I guess when parents make them get out and sell when it's coming off their pocket.
That's absolutely right. Of course, you got your little one with us. How are you?
Good.
Tell everyone who you are and tell us what grade you're in.
I'm Casey Park and I'm in third.
Third grade. Now, are you an athlete?
Yes, ma'am.
What sports do you play?
Baseball, football, and that's all.
And you're tall.
Mm-hmm.
In the third grade?
Mm-hmm.
You know you're going to be taller than me eventually.
Mm-hmm.
Don't brag about it.
That's
right. Now, listen, you got your former coach here.
Yes, ma'am.
And how did it feel for you to be able to have someone that was a mentor to you as an athlete to come in to talk with your boys?
Well, you know, it's always good to see, you know, your former coaches and, you know, guys that had a huge impact in, you know, in my life and especially in my career. You know, a lot of, like I tell the kids, you know, a lot of the things that I do as a coach are direct, you know, correlations to the guys that I had as a coach. And, you know, they don't get much better than Coach Polk.
That's right.
You know, been able to see him again. It's been, you know, probably 9 or 10 years since I've seen him. We keep in touch a good bit. So it was really good to see him and talk to him and to let him, you know, your guys to see kind of, you know, where you come from and the places you've been. So.
And, you know, to think about it, the fact that he coached you many years ago and some of the things that he's taught you has instilled within you is still in you today.
Well, thank you, ma'am. You know, you try to take it all of your, you know, experiences and all you try to build from them.
Right.
And that was one thing that he did. You know, we had many meetings and many talks, you know, when you're playing for them. And you know, just trying to teach you more than baseball and teach you how to be, you know, a good man. And you know, I really feel that taking some of the things that he did and seeing him as a coach and his role model is, you know, is a great example just to, you know, walk in his footsteps.
That's right. You know, and to see the guys, you know, as they're talking to him, he's putting his hand on their shoulder, you know, and they're telling him, I understand, you know, so they've definitely grasped something positive from this.
You know, I think he's a special guy. Mm-hmm. I think he's had, you know, he's a special has been given a gift, and I think he has made the most of it, you know, and it takes not many of us are lucky enough to find that, you know, that avenue, and he's done it, and, you know, more than anything, loves baseball, you know.
That's
he loves
right.
baseball, and he loves kids, and I really think, you know, when he says it, he wants something good to come from mm-hmm. each one of these kids, I mean, he means it. I've been there, so I know it's not just, a word or anything. He would do anything for any of these kids here. Just that's just the type of guy he is, and, you know, I was fortunate enough to be able to spend some time with him.
Absolutely, and thank you so much for sharing him with
thank
us.
Thank you, ma'am.
All right, ladies and gentlemen, we had a wonderful time here listening to the coach. And, of course, we got the Christian family here with us. We're going to let them introduce themselves and talk about what this experience was for them tonight. Hi, Mom.
Hey, how
talk
are you?
To us. Doing well. How are you?
I'm Kelly Christian, and my son Caleb is a senior at West Lawrence mm-hmm. this year. This will be his final season in baseball. I thoroughly enjoy Coach Polk. He's had a phenomenal career, mm-hmm. and to have someone of his stature to be able to come and talk right. to our boys. He had a great message for the boys mm-hmm. about how to work hard and how the next few years will influence mm-hmm. Their lives.
Yeah.
They're very important, and we just appreciate yeah. him giving up his time to
Absolutely.
Come here.
And, you know, and we want to thank you because, you know, there's always, you know, the background. You've got people who are working behind the scenes to make sure, like, an event like this comes to pass, and you mom. Moms, you girls are working hard back there.
Well.
And so we thank you so much.
Thank you very much. That's all for the boys in the program.
Absolutely. All right, Caleb, you ready for us? Mm-hmm. All right, talk to us. Tell us a little bit about yourself, okay?
Okay, well, I'm Caleb Christian, and I'm a senior at West Lawrence High School, and I played baseball for 4 years mm-hmm. here, and that's about it.
Now, Caleb, what has your experience been like here playing for the Raiders?
Oh, it's been fun. It's been unforgettable, and, mm-hmm. you know, I've made so many good friendships and memories throughout the years, so...
Listening to Coach Polk tonight, can you think of something in particular that will stick with you as an athlete?
Well, he said you need to strive to be the best person and not just a, you know, a baseball player. You need to strive and be the baseball player, the best you can be.
Mm-hmm. And, you know, I was looking at your teammates here as they're kind of cheering you on here in the background. You know, do you consider yourself a leader on your team?
I guess so, yeah. I mean, I think I am. Yeah. I guess they can help decide that this year, but hopefully we can lead the team to another region championship and hopefully something better.
Exactly right. So we appreciate everything that you do, Caleb, and, of course, the support system that you have right here.
Thank you very much.
Thank you. Ladies and gentlemen, this is the Christian family. All right, ladies and gentlemen, just to have the opportunity to meet some of the parents and, of course, the players themselves. Hi, guys.
Hello.
All right, Mama, introduce yourself to everyone and tell us about what you do to support your son.
My name is Tamara Davis, and I'm here to help the team in any way possible.
And how long have you been doing this?
Well, I've been a mom behind the scenes for ever, but this is our first year at West Lawrence.
Mm-hmm. Well, glad to have you here. All right, sir, your turn.
My name is Dalton Davis, and I'm a senior at West Lawrence, but I just transferred here.
Where'd you transfer from?
Dublin High School.
All right, very good. So you're still keeping it in the community. Mm-hmm. So let's tell us about things that you're involved in, if you would.
I'm involved in baseball and Beta Club.
Smarty pants. Very. All right, Dalton. Now listen. Listening to Coach Polk, what thing that most sticks out in your head as an athlete, something you can definitely take away with you and use?
Well, like his many stories and things like that. I mean, because he's a coach. He's been around the game that I love and all my friends love to play. And so, like, his experience and his time in the game is, like, definitely – it's like his outlook is definitely appreciated. Mm-hmm. And we enjoy listening to him tonight.
Yeah, we also did. And listen now, you've got your mom here, and she says she's been with you through thick and thin. What is it like for you to have a mom that supports you as she does? Are you speechless there?
I'm speechless.
I mean, the thing is, it's like this. As a mom of students who are athletes, you know, we pour a lot into our kids. And so there's a lot that we do to make you look good. And so to see your mom and the things that she does to help support you, how does that make you feel, son?
I really appreciate it. I mean, the stuff that my mom's done, a lot of people haven't seen. It's behind the scenes, like she said. But without her, I wouldn't be where I'm at today in many instances in life, in baseball, academic, and as a character that I built.
Absolutely. Now, Tamara, Mama.
Yes.
Does it do your heart proud to hear your son talk like that?
Yes, of course.
And so listen, you know, this is a big night tonight. I mean, the fundraiser, you had a crowd full of people, and you worked hard. You're still working. And so thank you so much.
Thank you.
And son, keep doing great things, okay?
Thank you.